Good morning and welcome to our devotion for Thursday morning. As we continue our journey through this season of Lent, we continue to be open to all that God is doing in us, with us, and through us. We continue to bring before God all the conditions of our world, remembering always that our responsibility is not to tell God what is happening in the world, but our responsibility is to be the best and brightest light that we can be. And that is our work, to deal with ourselves. As our Savior says, take the log out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. So our work is our self-work, and in doing our self-work, we trust that it will in some way transform our world and cause our world to be a better place. So we come into our space of healing and devotion at this time, as we open our hearts to all that is taking place around us, with us, in us, and through us, and we become present to each other as we come into our sacred space this morning. In that sacred space, we bring our attention to our hearts and we take a few deep breaths to send to ourselves and to bring ourselves to a place of gratitude and love. Remembering all those who have asked us to pray for them. And as we respond to their requests, we just hold them in the light. We just hold them in the light. And as we hold them in the light, we make sure that our light is as bright as we can get it, so that they can receive as much light from us as possible. And so we allow that divine presence to be with us this morning. We bring ourselves into that still, quiet place. And we listen. We listen with all of our senses. To discern how the Spirit is showing up in our lives this morning. Knowing that God is always with us. We are never alone. And so in this place of quiet and peace, we surrender ourselves and we open our hearts to receive and to give. Like a child at prayer, we are filled with awe at the presence of the divine. And all we can say really in truth is thank you. Thank you for the love. Thank you for the gift. Thank you for the blessing. The reading from Mark this morning is a reading that tells of some men who had come to see Jesus with the paralytic, and they just couldn't get into the place that Jesus was speaking. So Mark says that they went on the roof and they made a hole in the roof and they let the man down through the roof. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now, some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, "Why does this fellow speak in this way? It is blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" At once, Jesus perceived in his spirit what they were discussing, that they were discussing these questions among themselves. And he said to them, "Why do you raise such questions in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Stand up and take your mat and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, stand up, take your mat, and go to your home." Here is the reading. Have you ever considered how we don't really see dark anymore? You probably wonder what I'm talking about. But I'm taking you back 50, 60 years ago or more, when there was the lamp that was burning in the home. And the lamp was always placed in a kind of a general area, and everyone kind of gravitated towards that area, whether it was the dining room or the living room. And as a little child, especially if you had brothers and sisters, you kind of wait for everybody to be ready to go to bed so you wouldn't have to go into the dark on your own. And if you were so small, you couldn't really take the lamp with you, as your parents would be able to take the lamp from room to room and come back. But those were the days of dark, real dark. In our time, we don't get that kind of dark. There's so many street lights, and even where there aren't street lights, there would be our security lights, and light would be creeping in a window somewhere or another. And so we don't really see dark. And this has come to mind today because of this story that we're reading here with respect to Jesus and the paralytic. And what's striking is that Jesus doesn't refer to the man's faith. He refers to the faith of his friends, those who climb on the roof, open the roof, and let down the man. So Jesus says to the paralytic, because of the faith of his friends, your sins are forgiven thee. In a sense, there's a disconnect. Because it isn't the man's faith that has caused his sins to be forgiven. It is the faith of the friends. So, how do you get from the faith of the friends to the forgiveness of the sins of the man? There seems to be a gap in our thinking, at least. But such is the beauty of God. Such is the beauty of God. Faith is like light. It just needs a crack somewhere. And once it gets into the room, it serves its purpose. Nowadays, we don't have to have our lights on inside the house because light comes from outside and it diffuses, and there's enough to see. There's enough, even if we don't have to do anything particular, there's enough to just enable us to move from room to room or from space to space. We don't have that dead dark as we did in the past. And faith is very much like this. In this context, we see how faith of others filled the space with faith. Jesus is impressed by the faith of these persons who brought this man. And based on their effort and their faith, Jesus offers forgiveness of sins, release from that which is imprisoning. So faith creates the avenue for release. And the faith doesn't necessarily have to be in the particular individual, but the particular individual being open, as this man was, to the actions of the friends, he benefits from their faith. I think this is a beautiful testimony of how God works with all of us. It's not only about you. It's not only about me. It's also about us and what we do for each other. How we assist each other, how we lift each other up, how we give the other that little booster. Just like the man here gave the paralytic the booster he needed, not even just to get into the room, but to get on top of the roof and to come down and be the center of attention. The times we need friends like that, who work with us in our own paralysis, who become our feet to help us to get to where we're going, who lend us their full support to ensure that we don't miss out. Those are friends. And those are the friends that cause miracles to take place. When they are able to give themselves for the one or the other. Yet another lesson for us this Lent on how we are called to live. Because in a sense, the more we do the work on ourselves, the more available we become to each other. And we are not all the same strength. You know, back in the day, you would hear comments made like, you know, God isn't going to ask me for anybody but me. And when you reflect on that, as someone growing in faith, you realize how wrong that is. One can perhaps understand to some degree what the individual who would say such a thing was trying to imply, but in all reality, there's not separateness. God is a God of oneness. And you may remember that wonderful little parable that Jesus told about those whom the Father welcomed to the kingdom. And he would say, you know, I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you came and ministered to me. I was in prison and you visited me. And they would ask, when was it that we did this? And he said, you know, whenever you did it to one of the least, you did it to me. So even there, Jesus is reinforcing that it is about us. It is about us. When we do it for each other, the faith is seen, and the faith brings a response of love from God. So yes, there may seem to be an apparent gap between the faith of the friends and the forgiveness of the man's sins. But in reality, there is no such divide. It's all one. The expression of faith leads to the forgiveness of sins. We do it together. We share. We support. We are not alone. This is not me versus you. This is us. So as we journey. We begin with ourselves, yes. Because when we deal with ourselves, what we're doing is that we're taking down the walls of selfishness. And when we take down the walls of selfishness and we become our true selves, then there are no walls. And that true self that we are belongs to everyone else. It's connected to everyone else. So we begin with ourselves. Because if we don't begin with ourselves, we continue to perceive ourselves as separate from the other. And we hoard, and our greed becomes intense, and we see ourselves threatened by the other, which is all false, which is all just pure ego. So when we work on ourselves first and put the ego in its proper place as our servant, and not we being the ego's servant, then when the ego is our servant, then we're able to come into oneness with others. And we then realize it is not only about me. It's about all of us, every one of us. And that's what this work is about. So today, as we reflect on this wonderful story, and we hear Jesus' words, as a result of their faith, let it remind us that together there is so much that we are able to accomplish that we can't when we stay separate and selfish.